everybody. Welcome to another Champions Way webinar. This is Sensei Nick Doherty on behalf of Champions Way. We're very excited about today's webinar. These two gentlemen need no introduction whatsoever. Okay, Flavio and Ricardio Almeida. These guys are part of our Champions Way family, the Gracie Baja Association, and also the RABJJ Academy with Ricardio Almeida. These guys, we're really excited. All over Facebook, we've been promoting this webinar, explaining to school owners and instructors that this is a webinar you have to make sure that your staff attends. In today's marketing, everyone's always talking about social media, internet marketing, landing pages, and so forth. But this is going to give you a different perspective, because without having your passion in what you're teaching, you're not going to see any type of results. So without further ado, I want to turn it over to our brothers, Flavio and Ricardio Almeida.
How you doing, Sensei Nick? This is Ricardio Almeida here, everyone. Thank you for having us. I love jiu-jitsu, and I love every aspect of it, from being a student to being an instructor as well as a school owner. I could not imagine my life without jiu-jitsu, and that's pretty much what we're going to talk about today. You know, it's been a big influence in our family. I'm sitting right here next to my brother, who's also a jiu-jitsu black belt, and I'm going to give him the word. But you know, the main thing is have allowed us to stick together as a family, to feel like our family does have and make a difference in the world. And thanks everyone for having us.
Thank you, guys. This is Flavio Almeida speaking. Sensei Nick, thanks for putting this together, together with the Champions Way staff. It's a good opportunity for us to share a little bit of the work we've been doing together. I consider myself a lucky man in a lot of ways, and one of them is to have the influence of my brother in my life. You know, he's brought me into jiu-jitsu actually twice. When I was ready to take off and make jiu-jitsu just a hobby, when I graduated from the university, he dragged me back into it and made me move to the United States. So I owe a lot to him, and for the past year, we've been doing a lot of work together, and a big part of their work is related to jiu-jitsu instruction, you know, and taking it to the next level, or at least helping it to go to the next level. And we're here to share some of those thoughts with everybody. I also wanted to thank, I don't know how many people are in the room. It's kind of a weird dynamic, the webinar. It's not as good when you actually can look people in the eye, but I wanted to thank everybody for joining and making the time to be here with us. It's really exciting. Okay, so basically what we're going to be discussing today, and I know Ricardio and I, we have similar voices, so it's Flavio speaking still. It's the idea of teaching jiu-jitsu with passion, you know, and I think we had a brief introduction on the beginning. This is, it's key. It's a very essential aspect of the success of a martial arts school, is how much passion everybody on the team has for the style being taught. In our case, you know, we teach jiu-jitsu, and we live our lives through jiu-jitsu. Everything about it is jiu-jitsu. You know, my three-year-old daughter trains jiu-jitsu. My wife is an instructor. So it's part of our life, but that didn't happen by accident. It happened by design. You know, we always recognize that being passionate about what we do is the prerequisite for success. So we broke it down into four major concepts, and the fourth one is, it's basically a lot of practical information that we believe to be very applicable. When you guys go teach class today, you can actually use those things. But the idea of the webinar is, I will lead two concepts and Ricardio will lead two concepts, but we're basically going to be complementing each other. When it comes down to passion and desire for teaching, a big part of it is for the instructors to reflect and meditate on what's their responsibility as a martial arts instructor, you know, and the more narrow you define your role, the less exciting the job is going to be, you know. And I like to think of the idea of teaching martial arts, or the job of a martial arts instructor, at the highest level possible. In the life that I live, I see very few other professions that you can place such an enormous contribution to the lives of the people that interact with you. And that's really where my passion comes from. You know, and I also on my job at BJJ, I had an opportunity to interact with hundreds, if not thousands, of instructors, and I see different profiles, and I kind of have this framework in my mind. When I see somebody who is not in front of the class, who is not really excited about teaching, I see that they don't really understand how important their job is, you know. And I read a story once, I never forgot. Maybe some of you guys have heard this before, but just to share with you, there's basically these three guys working on building a wall, you know, and they're tearing the rocks apart and they're putting everything together, and a person comes by and asks for the first guy, hey man, what you doing? He's like, man, you know, I'm breaking rocks all day, you know, and this sucks, but that's my job. And the person walks a little bit further and talks to the second guy. And the second guy is, you ask, hey man, what you doing there? Man, I'm breaking wall, breaking rocks so I can build a wall, you know. And the person walks to the third guy and says, hey man, what's up, what you doing? And the guy says, oh, I'm building a church. Who do you think the most exciting guy is, you know? Who do you think is the most passionate? So it's really about how you see your job. And to bring it down to our day-to-day reality as a jiu-jitsu instructors, we're not just training people, you know. And we actually are not just teaching them like martial arts skills or teaching them how to fight. You know, that's just a tool for us to be able to mentor them and to coach them into a better version of themselves. You know, so I think that if every martial arts instructor, every jiu-jitsu instructor realizes that they're not there to teach an armbar, they're there to change the lives of their students and take that level of responsibility, in other words, expand their job description, they're going to have a lot of passion to teach jiu-jitsu every day, no matter how many hours you teach per day. Hey everyone, Ricardo here. So whenever we do the back and forth, just because like sometimes either our mom confuses our voice on the phone, I'll try to reintroduce myself, and Flavio will try to introduce himself so that you guys, you know, so we don't leave you guys wondering who's speaking. So, you know, what is our source of passion? That's something that we're going to talk about, and I can't really tell you guys what yours should be, but I could tell you what mine is, and me and Flavio share a very similar source, you know, like a very similar way of looking at why we teach martial arts, you know. As I mentioned earlier, everything I have in my life, I got from jiu-jitsu. My son is named after my teacher, Enzo, you know, like my daughter is named after my brother. Just jiu-jitsu is something that has always kept us very close. The house that I bought, the car that I drive, you know, everything was one way or another related to martial arts. All my friends pretty much train, you know, like I just love every aspect of it, from teaching a little kid's class where, you know, my son was diagnosed with autism and is often the one who needs the most attention, all the way up to, you know, last Saturday night I was in Denver for the main event of the UFC coaching my student Frankie Edgar, who's also a brown belt. You know, so every aspect of it excites me. But did you guys lose me, Sensei?
Just for a second, Professor, but we're good now.
We're good? Okay. So every aspect of it excites me, but what I'm really excited about is to be able to give back. Jiu-Jitsu has allowed me to live a richer and fuller life in every way, you know, from being more confident about myself to being more disciplined and achieving greater results. Definitely, you know, a way healthier life than I would have been if I was sitting in front of a desk all day looking at a computer and, you know, doing whatever it is that other people do at their jobs. So I believe I've been a greater influencer for my children and for the people around me. And, you know, I want to share that with as many people as possible. They don't have to be a full-time martial arts instructor to reap those benefits from martial arts training. You know, to live a healthier life, to be more confident, to be more disciplined and apply the principles they learn on the mats to their daily lives and become greater professionals and become greater family members. And that's really my exciting, my motivation to teach jiu-jitsu. And, you know, if you could summarize in one
one phrase is the service to others. You know, we hear Zig Ziglar say that, you know, if you help as many people as possible get what they want, you get everything you want in return, you know, like, so it's very exciting and motivating to me to be able to live the martial arts lifestyle, to live the jiu-jitsu lifestyle and get compensated well for it. You know, like a little bit later, we're going to talk about, you know, money, you know, like what does it mean in this whole thing that we're talking about? And I really don't apologize for getting well rewarded for providing a service that I believe is world class. And I don't think anyone who works very hard at their craft, works very hard on their school, should apologize for being monetarily rewarded. You know, like people want to say that if you really love martial arts, you should teach in your, you know, in your basement and not charge, you know, at the rec center and not charge. I say, and I commend all the professional jiu-jitsu and martial arts instructors out there. If you love martial arts, you have your name on at least a $10,000 lease, and you have a big school with, you know, a couple hundred students, and, you know, they have to make ends meet from Monday through Monday, you know, and it's all about serving people and enhancing their lives and, you know, being able to welcome everybody from your community into your school. Yes. Guys, it's Flavio back in here, and I think this might be too philosophical for some, but we all get burned out every once in a while, you know, and there's situations in your day that, you know, you woke up early, you trained, and then you had staff meetings, and then you know, you studied the class, you had the class plan, you taught like 5 hours, and you still have about 2 more to teach, and there's times you get tired, and that's a time that, you know, a brief meditation on what's the source of your passion, or what's your purpose, or why you're there in the first place, you know, it can bring the motivation back to you. Believe me, it works much better than a can of a Monster Red Bull. I've done it many times, and I use that technique to motivate myself. But I think there's a lot of debate, you know, especially in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I don't think our industry is as advanced in terms of like business and marketing-wise as some other styles like Taekwondo and Karate. There's a lot of, I could probably say prejudice to the idea of making money out of teaching Jiu-Jitsu. And what I like to tell the Gracie Barra guys is, look, I'm not in this for the money. None of you guys are in this for the money. If it was about making money, or if you're here to make money, you chose the wrong profession. You know, or if you're here to, correcting my words, if you're here to become rich, you chose the wrong profession, you know. You better work for the financial market. And I like to use myself as an example. I'm an economist. I had a job as I was doing consulting for big banks like HSBC in Citibank in Brazil. And if it was about being rich, I was going to be there, not here. And I'm here because I love what I do, you know. But being rewarded or financially rewarded for what I do is also a prerequisite for jiu-jitsu and my students to get the best of myself. Because providing for my family, getting my family a decent life is a priority number one for any man or any responsible man. If I'm not able to provide my family with a decent life, I would still be teaching jiu-jitsu, but I'll be working for banks around 12 or 15 hours a day, then teach jiu-jitsu with whatever is left of me. So if jiu-jitsu in Ricky Barra was the best of myself, you know, it's got to give me a good life, and that's how it's got to go. So that's just for people to understand that money shouldn't really be the key motivator for you to be in class or to be following this profession. It's really like the idea of servicing others and helping other people improve their lives through jiu-jitsu, through the style that you teach. And when you actually see that happening, that's the biggest motivation. And the second idea that I wanted to bring in is, if you study a little bit the history of jiu-jitsu and you go back to Carlos Gracie Sr., who is, you know, the link in the Gracie family between the Japanese version of jiu-jitsu and the Brazilian jiu-jitsu that we all know today, in his biography, it's very clear that what motivated him to design and pursue the project of, you know, building jiu-jitsu, building his style of jiu-jitsu and teaching jiu-jitsu for everyone, was actually the fact that he wanted to give back to as many people as possible what jiu-jitsu has done for him. It has done a lot. You know, he came from being a very wild kid to being like almost like a saint, you know, a mentor
to hundreds of people in Brazil. And what drove him to start this project, you know, him and his brother Helio had, you know, almost 20 sons each, and they created the Gracie clan and everything that followed after, you guys know the whole story. But the ultimate source of motivation and passion was actually to give back. And it's no different than with us. Right? You can move on now, right? So on the next slide, guys, we talk about the focus of martial arts success. I had most of the piece, so it makes it a little bit easier for everyone to remember. And we'll talk a little bit about it. You know, like I believe those are key: purpose, passion, patience, and perseverance. And I think I wrote a blog post a while back that I gave it to my students, and I posted it on my website. And it was more geared towards, you know, mastering the technical elements of jiu-jitsu for someone with a white belt seeking to be a black belt. But I believe it also applies for us school owners. You know, no matter what I do, I always consider myself a student first, and I always try to tie my success in any endeavor that I take, and with the ability to learn concepts and apply concepts, you know, which is essentially what we do on the mats, or what we do with our gi on, depending on practice the most works, then we actually stand up there and we need the mat. Let's talk about purpose. Viktor Frankl talks about if you have a big enough why, you figure out how. You know, like, what is the mission? You know, like, my mission is to teach jiu-jitsu to as many people as possible. You know, we're gonna have the star champions that come in, and it's almost like you just need to get out of their way and let them do what they do. That's kind of my approach with Frankie Edgar. You know, like, you cannot take credit for a champion. You know, champions are not made. They're not born, they're made, but they're also self-made. You know, like any coach out there who tries to take credit for any success of one of their students is just ruining themselves. You know, like we just had the Olympics. How many coaches got the gold medal? Well, none of them. You know, like as an instructor, I try not to get distracted with the idea that I make Frankie Edgar the champion that he is. You know, like that's just not true. You know, Frankie Edgar makes himself a champion, and that's what it is. And I'll just go back to, you know, this morning. I was away for the fight last weekend, and Saturday morning, it's pretty hot here in California. I'm here in California, and we didn't have the air conditioning at the school. And one of the parents is like flipping out, trying to get a little kid off the mat and telling the kid to take the key top off and go back to class. Without the gi in the class, there was gi and talk with the gi. Anyway, it was just like a little bit of a issue that we were having with our air conditioning. And you know, the parent wrote a note, and here I am. You know, I come back from, no matter where I come back from, whether it's from a fight or if I come back from you know, a vacation, you know, still Monday morning, you know, you have to do the calls and you have to serve the people that are under your guidance. And I called this parent and I apologize and I say, sir, you know, you're totally right. You know, the air conditioning should have been on, and you could bet that it's going to be on next time. Of course, if it was something too out of what I believe a parent should talk about in school, I would be just as firm as I would be nice. But when we drop the ball, I believe it's our job to go and make it up, go out of our way to make it up to the student or the parent. And, you know, again, what is the purpose? What is the mission? I believe any team member, anyone who's on your team, you know, just like a Navy SEAL special ops, you know, like the mission comes first. Any team member should be willing to sacrifice towards the chief aim, the ultimate goal, the ultimate purpose, which is to teach martial arts to as many people as possible. Number two, passion. You know, so here's where I wanted to discuss money with everyone. And I can't, you know, tell you guys like a whole truth or how things should be done, or, you know, I can only speak from my perspective. You know, money is a measure of progress. You know, like, just like when I was competing, you know, a win or a gold medal in a tournament is inspiration, and it's a measure of progress, and, you know, it's good to have, but it should not be your ultimate source of passion. You know, like my brother Flavio was saying, if your passion is money, you know, you are in the wrong profession. You know, like our passion should be to serve our students and to
you want to make more money, just serve more students. It's pretty straightforward. Get better at serving people. And how do we get better? It just goes back to being a student. You know, you have to be so that you can have. It comes down to behave. You know, you have to do the routines that are going to turn a white belt into a blue belt to purple, and brown and black belt. It's all about, you know, diligent behavior. And I want to use a quote from Master Elio Gracie. If you do what you love, you don't have to work a day in your life. You know, like, that was his whole philosophy. Like I love what I do. I would, you know, if I wasn't getting paid to do what I do, I think I would figure out a way to do it for free. You know, I'd probably have another job and volunteer to teach martial arts. You know, once I was done, it would probably be like my second job or, you know, some type of volunteer. I was lucky enough and privileged enough and blessed enough to have great mentors and great teachers in my life who have taught me not only how to execute high-level, world-class jiu-jitsu moves, but also how to care enough about people so that they could have a life on our mat. And eventually, I've had other teachers like Sensei Nick and, you know, some of the help of Champions Way to teach us a little bit about, you know, the marketing and other elements where I was lacking. You know, I believe, like, how do we tie that, you know, like this whole fashion thing, you know, like, how do we make more money? How do we make ends meet? You know, like, just, you know, I love the old karate thing with seek perfection and things like that. You know, I believe you should seek perfection of your skill. You know, if it's on the mat, for us, jiu-jitsu with arm locks and kilts, you know, and if it's karate, you know, the kicks, if it's kickboxing, you know, but once we become an instructor, our skill is not just the martial skill, it's communication skill, and you know, it's a sensitivity to you know, what the student's goal is, you know, so perfect the skill, perfect our physical attributes, you know, like, I can remember at a time where I couldn't spend more than an hour in front of the computer, you know, like, now I have to have the ability to do more, all right, I've never been the greatest at organizing things, I'm learning so much from my brother, you know. So we have to perfect our skills, perfect our physical attributes, and also perfect our mental capacity, like our thinking ability, our analytical ability, you know, like our ability to follow through. So many of these things are important, and we don't really realize that we learn so many of those on the mat. When we come off the mat, everything becomes, you know, about money and getting a little bit more sleep or eating whatever we want. You know, like if we're disciplined enough with our training, I believe anything on off the mat is easy. And if you have the passion to be a full-time martial artist, I believe anything else is easy to master. Let's talk about patience. It's not going to happen overnight. You know, no matter how disciplined, how talented, how great, you know, some people think they are, it's still going to take time to become good at what you do. You know, so when we talk about, you know, being like a business owner and having a successful business, when I kind of go back and, you know, it's about the time it takes to get black belt, you know, 5 years, or you guys ever read the book by Malcolm Gladwell, The Outliers? He talks about the 10,000 hours rule, which means that it takes 10,000 hours of diligent practice to master anything. From playing the violin to being, you know, a great hockey player to being a great martial artist, as well as to being a great business owner. I'll give a little bit of a breakdown for you guys, all right? Most of us work 8 hours per day, you know, 40-hour week. So we're talking about 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, times 50, you know. The year has 50-some weeks, but, you know, let's say that 1 week you work less than there. So 8 times 5 times 50, that's 2,000. You're going to put about 2,000 hours in to work 5 days a week, 8 hours. All right? You multiply that by 5, you're going to get 10,000 hours. So no matter where you are now, if you want to master anything, all right, be it, you know, the marketing in your school, be it, you know, financial planning, all right, or financial management. And, you know, you want to learn another martial art. Like now it's the days of MMA where we all want to, you know, not only we feel like we need to, but we're inspired to learn other martial arts. I want to learn more about striking. I want to learn more about takedowns, you know. We have to take 10,000 hours to master that and be pretty damn good at it to the point where you're teaching and inspiring others, you know. Like, that's the challenge. So no matter what you are now, it will only take 5 years of, you know, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, and you have those 10,000 hours on your side. And I believe no matter where you're starting from or what you're trying to master, you'll be
pretty damn good at it. Number four, perseverance. Perseverance is the one that comes in when the three ones that we mentioned before are not quite not there, or maybe they're not in sync, or maybe they're not in balance. So when maybe you forget your purpose, all right? The passion is really like lacking a little bit. You don't feel like as motivated, and you know, you're impatient and you're not really being diligent. That's when perseverance kicks in. You know, like, if you haven't thought about quitting, if you haven't thought about, hey, this is too hard, it's too complicated, I feel like I put too much time, and the students keep quitting, you know, like, I can't really get the leads. You know, if you haven't thought about quitting, you're not building the most important attribute of any martial artist, which is the non-quitting spirit. Like, that ability to persevere through anything. You know, we got to get over this wall. We could take a hole, go under it. We could climb over it, all right? We could shoot it with a bazooka and go through it. You know, we'll figure out how, all right? And that's really the most important attribute of martial arts on the mat, martial arts off the mat. You know, being a business owner, you know, like time management, whatever it is, if you feel like it's time to persevere, it's time to push through, you know, it's time to, I'll use Sensei Nick's favorite word, hustle. You know, you gotta hustle. You have to stay disciplined and committed. You know, you only turn iron into steel in the fire. You know, like, you just have to welcome that pressure. If you're a small business owner in America, that's the cargo we're dealt with. You know, but still, I'd rather work for myself. All right, I'd rather work with the team than work for somebody who has no idea. And most importantly, my students need me. My students trust me. So for me to even think about quitting or feeling like I'm not strong enough or feeling like, you know, maybe I should do something else would be a betrayal of their trust. So I'll just keep going no matter what the obstacles. Wait. I almost feel like there's nothing to add after that. Anyways, guys, Flavio back in. You know, Ricardo and I, we tend to, you know, in our conversation at our house, we, you know, this pretty much dominates, you know, dinner tables and you know, every opportunity with that, and, you know, we discuss and we talk about jiu-jitsu really with the end in mind of teaching to as many people as possible and making the biggest contribution in the lives of our students, being at Ricardo Almeida Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu or within the Gracie Barra network of, you know, it's over 300 schools worldwide. So, and the work at Gracie Barra is interesting because, you know, when you develop a new curriculum for your school, you're really reaching to 300, maximum 500 students, right? At Gracie Barra, you know, we're just coming up with our new curriculum for beginners that Ricardo helped a lot. We're really talking about reaching thousands and thousands of students all over the world. So it's a pretty exciting thing, and of course, it adds on to our motivation. But, you know, going back to the reality of a teaching instructor and a school owner, you try to get something practical out of it. You know, I know it can be pretty philosophical when we're discussing, you know, motivation and purpose. But it's one of these bullet points we choose because these are things that we use on a daily basis either with ourselves, our staff, or our students. Okay, and again, it's our hope that you guys can go back to your schools and teach classes tonight, and this is going to be of service. We hope. So purpose, well, there's no passion, there's no motivation without purpose. You know, purpose comes, motivation comes from purpose. If you don't know where you're going, you have no motivation to walk forward. That's just human nature. So if you feel like your staff, if you think your staff is lazy, or if you think your students are lazy, you're wrong. You're absolutely wrong. There's no such a thing as being lazy in human nature. It is only lack of purpose. So you as a leader, you can empower yourself at the moment you attribute people's shortcomings to them being lazy. But, you know, there's nothing I can do about these guys just lazy. You know, what I'm going to do with him? I'm going to fire him. Or what am I going to do with this student? I'll let him quit. Well, as a leader, you can't do that. As an instructor, as a mentor, you can't do that. You have to understand why this person doesn't have the fire and the motivation, and where exactly it's lacking the purpose. They're not really understanding, they are not seeing the connection. Okay. So the second idea is goal setting. You know, purpose is something abstract. You're really looking at it from 30,000, 50,000 feet. You know, goal setting is like all right, so, you know, my goal is to live a better life through jiu-jitsu, or, you know, or to accomplish a better version of myself through the practice of martial arts. That's the reason why I came. Or my goal is, you know, I want to just say, all right, let's discuss this and understand it better. What exactly you want? What does it mean to get fit? You want to lose? How many pounds do you want to lose? You know? And goal is something specific. You know, in business, it's something you can measure. You know, in martial arts training, it's something that's very material. You know, and if your students don't have a goal that is connected with their purpose, eventually they're gonna fail to see what's the purpose of this. So you help to, you not only help to remember them what's the purpose, what brought them in the first place, but you have to daily, every day remind them that, you know, what's their goal. And this, the third thing that follows is you have as a guide, as a mentor, the person who's guiding your students and your staff, you have to, it's your responsibility to help them make progress. See, like, making progress doesn't mean that you're walking for them. Making progress means that you're helping them walk. You're helping them, and above all things, you're helping them overcome the obstacles. You know, I can't tell you how many times I'm talking to students or to a co-worker or one of my staff members, and all they're talking about is how frustrated they are because of the obstacle that is ahead of them. You know, you have to help them deal with that and not focus so much on the obstacle, but focus on where they're going and help them overcome the obstacle. But above all things, it's your responsibility to help your students make progress. But the moment they stop making progress, or they're perceiving they're not making progress, that's the moment you're going to lose them. Or at least you're going to lose their passion, you're going to think they're going to lose them. Now, the fourth idea, and that one is pretty practical, and that's pretty awesome. And I learned this right when I came to the United States from my brother Ricardo. You know, it's the fact, it's the understanding or the realization that enthusiasm is contagious, and so is the lack of it. And it goes on something pretty interesting. You know, if you're thrilled, if you're really like extremely crazy about your class or about doing a presentation or about doing a speech, people who are listening to it, your audience is going to be excited. If you are excited, you're going to be motivated. If you are motivated, you're going to be interested. And if you are just interested, you're going to be bored. And if you are bored as a mentor, as an instructor, as a speaker, you know, people are going to be walking away from the room. They're going to be quitting your school. They're going to be asking you know, to live with home. So the reality of it is the audience or the people who are you are leading are always going to be one level below you. You know, so you have, as a leader, as an instructor, you have to be always very excited by using everything that we discussed previously. The other idea that we wanted to bring in is feedback is extremely important. But feedback, any feedback, you know, like criticism can destroy people's ability to believe in themselves and can, again, hurt or damage too well their motivation, their passion. And eventually they're going to leave. So what you really want to use is a positive influence. It's another concept I learned from my brother is the PCP method. I'm sure some of you guys are familiar with it. We didn't invent this thing. The P is in capital, as you guys can see, because it's the idea of praise, you know. And C is correct. It's pretty fast, right? So every time you want to address the behavior or you want to fix something your students are not doing correctly, you gotta use the PCP map. In other words, it's phrase, you correct any phrase, you know? And I like to refer, every time I talk about this, I like to refer to Dr. Boozy or Stephanie Boozy, who passed a couple months ago. He wrote The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And I read that book in my early 20s, and I still have it close to my bed, and I go back to it every once in a while. One of the most interesting things he has in that book is the idea of an emotional bank account. In building relationships. And as a mentor, as a leader, you have to have a strong relationship with those that are looking up to you, you know, and relationships are like a bank account, you know, you make deposits and you make withdrawals, right? A good way to make deposits, you're just a kind person, you know. A great way to make a withdrawal is for you not to honor your promises, okay, or for you to be offensive with somebody, right? So
when in a relationship break, when the relationship breaks, it's because you made too much withdrawals without any deposit. You know, you have a deficit on that bank account, and you know, you're in a pretty bad situation with that person, right? So applying it to a relationship between a professor and an instructor and a student, you're really talking about constantly making deposits into the emotional bank account, meaning you want to invest on that relationship by praising, sincere praising, not just like praising just because. It's something that you actually saw that the student did correctly, and you praise it, and then you correct it, and then you praise it again. You know, you want to over deposit, and you want to, you don't want to withdraw, so you can always use a credit with that person. I hope that makes sense. And the last concept that we wanted to bring in is that you just got to care. You know, like if you don't care about your students, none of what you said is going to make a difference. You know, like you have to have honest care and sincere consideration for your students' progress. You know, you got to make sure it's coming from your heart, and if it's not, revisit your purpose and analyze yourself and meditate on why you decided to be a martial arts instructor in the first place. But if you really care, you know, you have to, you know, and I just wanted to wrap this up. I'll pass the word back to reporters. It's not how much you know, it's how much you care. You know, I've seen world champions fail as instructors many, many times in my life because they thought just because they knew so much of the technical side of jiu-jitsu, people are going to follow. You know, people want you to care first. Then they care how much you know. Okay? So I'll pass the word now back to Ricardo, and we're getting ready to wrap this up, I guess. Hey, I want to thank everyone for spending some time with us this afternoon. You know, it feels like in sharing some of these ideas with you guys, it really allows us to reinforce those ideas for ourselves. I can't wait to get to the school in a couple hours and teach a great class and talk my staff up. So hopefully we did a little bit of that for everyone who's on the other side of the line. You know, thank you guys for being here and holding all of us to high standards and allowing us to influence you, but also putting us in a position to push ourselves to the next level. And, you know, thank you guys for being, you know, my peers and inspiring us to be more and do more.
Thank you so much, Professor. Guys, a big round of applause for Professor Ricardo Flavio Almeida. You guys, just amazing content as usual. Amazing tips for school owners and instructors. Hopefully everybody in here was taking notes. This webinar will be recorded. It was recorded, and it will be available at a later date. And just again, we wanted to thank you guys, you know, on behalf of Champions Way for taking time out of your schedule to do this webinar for the clients. And also, this is a great sneak peek for anyone that's coming to the C-Way to see exactly, you know, just what you guys will be speaking about and, you know, just the amount of information you can learn from these two gentlemen. So thank you so much, guys, for taking the time out. I know how busy you guys are. I mean, Ricardo was just at a UFC fight, you know, coaching Frankie Edgar on Saturday. I mean, and he's now in California. And Flavio is all over the world as well. So I just wanted to personally thank you guys as well. Thank you so much for taking the time out to do this for our clients.
Thank you, guys. It's my pleasure. Thank you so much. I'm looking forward to seeing you around. Thank you. I'll see everyone at the C-Way.
Thanks, guys. And real quickly, guys, if anyone out there watching the webinar has not registered for the C-Way, it's October 19th and 20th at the Hyatt Regency Orange County. Professor Ricardo Almeida and Flavia will both be speaking there. We also have Dave Kovar, Tom Kalos, Roland Osborne, Melody Schumann, Master Frido Dar, Sean Jimenez. I hope I'm not forgetting anybody. Robert Drysdale, I think I said Master Ace. Just go to our website for more information on that. Make sure you register as soon as possible. So we also have another webinar, okay, which will be the 23rd. That will be Kiyoshi Kovar. If you're not familiar with him, he'll be doing an instructor certification at the C-Way. It's all included. Okay, you can get your staff you know, certified through Kiyoshi for his instructor training boot camp, which is definitely highly recommended for anyone teaching martial arts. And his webinar, you can register right on our championsway.com website. You can check out more information there. It's only $99. That's the. I'm just getting a note here. That is an unbelievable price for everything you're getting for this event with the speakers. So definitely make sure you register for that. And again, on behalf of Champions Way, I'd like to thank Sean Jimenez, Kyle Byers for all your help and effort, and obviously the Alameda brothers for taking time out of your schedule for doing this today. And this is Sensei Nick signing off.